Today's webinar, we have Anna Hasper. Welcome, Anna. Can you unmute your mic? Can you say something? Hello?
Hi, Will. How are you?
I'm very well, thanks, Anna. How are you doing?
I'm good, thanks.
Great. Okay, so to introduce Anna a little bit, she is an ELT teacher. She's a teacher trainer slash presenter, originally from New Zealand, but currently basing herself in Dubai. She's currently a teacher trainer on the Cambridge accredited courses, both face-to-face and online. And on top of that, she also writes for English Teaching Professional and Modern English Teacher, not to mention being part of the wonderful Macmillan English family, and specifically the Back to School webinar series as well. So Anna, I'm gonna hand it over to you to start telling us about students taking control of their learning. Great to see you, and I'm going to give you the reins now.
Fabulous. Thanks, Will. First of all, welcome, everyone. And I've been looking at this chat box, and it's absolutely amazing. Morocco, Turkey, Greece, Switzerland, Philippines. So very exciting. And thank you so much for joining us today. And I also want to say thank you to Macmillan, in particular to Federica and Will for organizing all this. And you've got a fabulous lineup. If you haven't looked at the other speakers, I really strongly suggest you go and have a look and sign up for those webinars too. And of course, go and check out One Stop English, because there's a lesson plan linked to this webinar as well. In a couple of days, probably next week, it will be there. So good. So for some of you, it's probably good morning. For some of you, it's maybe good afternoon, good evening. For me, it's definitely good afternoon, and I'm speaking to you from Dubai. Now, I'm not going to ask you where you are based, because I can see a lot of countries and city names already in the chat box. I do want to tell you, just to be aware, if you want to contact me, please find me on LinkedIn, find me on Twitter, Facebook, and I'm always happy to talk to you and explain more things after the webinar. So feel free to connect if that's what you would like to do. But the most important message, I think, is this one. And I think Will already said, with the certificate, there's loads of you, so be patient. But also, I'm talking to you from my home. And I think a lot of other people in Dubai are still working from home. So in case I disappear, the internet stops, please don't panic. Be patient, have a little stretch, do some shoulder rolls. We will be back, yeah? I can't promise it won't happen, but let's cross our fingers. But please stay with us and be patient, yeah? Good, so looking at that face, that was a little bit my feeling so far about 2020. I think for most of us teachers, it's been a very interesting year. I don't know what it's been like for you, but it started all right. January, lovely, with the students in the classroom. And then along came February. In Dubai, things got a little bit more serious because, of course, COVID-19 popped up unexpectedly. So our April holidays changed to March, and actually we never got back to school, because at that stage in April we started to provide online education. So since April we've been teaching online. I don't know if it was really teaching initially, it was probably a little bit more stress than teaching, but we're doing our best, I think, like all of us, because I'm pretty sure a lot of you have experienced that too. And then luckily, we had the school holidays, which was absolutely fabulous, with a little break and some time to actually think about what we had been doing, to refresh my knowledge, time to read, trying to study a little bit, and also some time to recharge my batteries on the beach. Yeah. So my question before I'm going to start today is, like, what did you do to refresh and recharge this holiday? Can you type some things in the chat box that you did that were maybe not related to school? While I have a quick look at my microphone. Right, is this better then? Some people are saying you can't hear me. listening, reading, attending webinars. Well, I actually have to say, I have been attending a lot of webinars in my summer holiday, the recorded ones, because we just had no time. Taekwondo or painting, study online courses. Wow. So lots of very interesting things. And I think this has been a beautiful opportunity, actually, for us with all these webinars to get all these PD from our comfort of the home. So that must have been lovely. So before we go to look a little bit more at 2020, I quickly want to give you an overview of the session. Yeah. So we're going to set the context. I already started a little bit. I'm going to go into depth a little bit more and look at our audience. Then we're going to explore that concept of learner independence. What is it? Before we start to look at how can we do this in a classroom. And Q&A, if you have been in my webinars before, I normally say type your questions in the chat box and I do my best to answer the questions. If not, we've got some time at the end and you know where to find me online as well. So absolutely amazing. A lot of you have been reading, studying, attending those webinars, doing some courses. And I think there has been an amazing opportunity for us to get ready for the future. But I think the big question for all of us really is what is next? And I think Will might have asked it already, but I'm really curious to see which of these options are going to happen in your context in September. 2020 is back to school. Are you going to go back face to face, online? That could be via Zoom or maybe via Edmodo, synchronous or asynchronous. Is it going to be blended, a little bit of you in the classroom with your students and a little bit online? Or is it going to be hybrid? Now, if you're not sure what hybrid is when we have students face-to-face in the classroom and the other students are beaming in via Zoom or Skype because they're remotely studying with us. Or maybe you are going to choose number 5 because you have no idea what is happening yet. Face-to-face, I see quite a lot there, blended. Ah, Gaza, so I'm not the only one who isn't sure yet then what's going to happen. Irini, 3, blended. Lovely to see you here. Good, face-to-face. I think, Elf, that is really true. A lot of universities haven't really said how they're going to go back. So, Nabila, indeed, we don't know what is going to happen yet for a lot of us. It's still a little bit in the air. Mariana, too, lovely. Good, I think we are actually all in the same water, but maybe in a different floaty. Yeah. Chia used this similar expression in her webinar in May, and it really resonated with me. To be in the same water, but to be in a different boat. Now, kids are in floaties, so hence this picture. We're all facing similar challenges, right? So one of the challenges we have is the parents. They want their kids to go back to school. They want to resume education as they've always known it. Then we've got the children. They really miss their friends. They like to be surrounded by their buddies. However, they've had some quite traumatic experiences, not being able to go to school in some countries, not being able to go out or go to the park. And then for us as well, we really want our kids to keep learning. Doesn't matter if we go back face-to-face, online, or hybrid, we want them to keep learning, but we all face this uncertainty. If we go back to the classroom later this month, how long will it last? And what we will be doing at the end of the year? It's this huge insecurity and the uncertainty, I think, for all of us, because it might not be the same for the rest of the school year. We might get a lot of changes again. We might be in the classroom for 2 weeks, back home, 1 month, back home. We just don't know. But I think one of the worries and one of the concerns a lot of educators have is that kids will be less exposed to learning, and in our case, language learning. So the question is really, how do we keep them learning? Even when they're at home, how do we keep them going? And one of the issues there is, of course, that learner independence is invaluable but not so easy to develop. So I hope in today's webinar to give you some tips about what you can do in the classroom to start developing that. And if I say classroom, I mean the online classroom, the face-to-face classroom, or maybe even your Edmodo or your Google Classroom, whatever context you are in. And Elif, I think that is true. Parents are also quite afraid of this, what's going to happen. They're working from home. Who is going to bring what home? There's a lot of challenges for us this year. Good. So before I'm going to take you through the activities that I think, or should probably call them strategies or maybe structures that we're going to look at today, I want to explore our audience a little bit more in detail, because there's loads of teachers here today that have logged on, which is absolutely amazing, but I don't know anything about your context. So can you type in the chat box what sort of age group you are teaching? It might be a wide range, it might be a one grade, for example. Lovely. Teenagers, wow, preschoolers, 7 to 19, that's a huge age range, isn't it? Six-year-olds, kindergarten, adult classes, lovely. Toddlers, wow, grade 3 till 6, primary, mixed. I think that is probably the best summary right today. Quite a mixed bag if I look at it. So if we look at how we would develop or how we would spread up young learners, because it's a very broad term that we use a lot in education. This is according to UNESCO. We speak about early years when you indeed teach play school or that's your pre-primary. Primary is 6 till 10 years old approximately, and then you have your secondary. So your teens would maybe go into lower and upper secondary there. Yeah, so we have quite a different age range, and I can see you are all teaching different age ranges as well, which is fabulous, but I just want you to be aware that in the webinar today, most of the activities I'll be looking at are for this age group, 6 till 10 year olds. But again, when you look to us at a six-year-old or a 10-year-old, there's a huge difference in development between that age group, right? So we always need to see, is this developmentally appropriate? Because I'm not such a big fan of saying it's age appropriate, because I've never met 2 7-year-olds that are exactly the same in development. Yeah, so with the activities we're looking at about this age group, however, if you teach teenagers, I'm sure that you can adapt them and do something with it if you see this is useful for my learners. If you teach younger learners, maybe 4, 5, 6-year-olds, you can probably adapt it and use it in a different way with them as well. So I hope there is something for you to take away from this session. Yeah. Now I'm going to hopefully please the lower secondary teachers a little bit before we get started, because this activity is not something you want to do with very young learners. Maybe something with primary, but they need to have quite a bit of language available. Yeah. So for the next activity, because of course I'm going to ask you to do lots of things, and hopefully you can see how you can use that in the classroom. For the next activity, I need you to get some paper and a pencil, or if you don't have that, you can use the chat box, completely up to you. Yeah. My question is about young learners. So we're going to explore what they are like. Yeah. So maybe you have got your paper and pencil ready. If not, you can start using the chat box. Oh, lovely. I see some familiar names as well. Lovely. Thank you, Nabila. Good. So it's your choice, but if you're going to use the chat box, listen carefully. Don't send to me until I say 1, 2, 3. So if you're going to use the chat box, are you going to type send, type send, type send, or are you going to stop and wait until you hear 1, 2, 3? Please let me know. So I'm just checking my instructions. You're going to wait, Mahasin. Beautiful. If you use paper and a pencil, you can start writing and doing whatever you want directly. Yeah? Good. So you're ready. You've got paper and pencil, or you've got the chat box ready. what you need to do is think about young learners and think about which words you associate with young learners. So you're going to write down on your own for 30 seconds a couple of words, six words, an adverb that you associate with young learners, a plural noun, an adjective, a singular noun, a number, and a verb. Yeah. So anything, no wrong, no right, any words of this category that you associate with young learners. I'm going to be quiet to give you some thinking time. Good. I don't think I've said one, two, three yet, but if you are ready, if you have some words, you can send it to me. One, two, three. Pooja, you were first. Wow. Fabulous. Hilke, beautiful. Oh, Raymark, some interesting words there. Now, make sure that you remember the words you have typed because you are not finished yet. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you the text and what you need to do. When you see gap number one, you need to put in your word. Yeah, so if you say, are young learners lazy? Okay, gap number one, you're going to put in the word lazy. So insert your words while you read about young learners and let me know if it's funny, interesting, or if it makes total sense. Here you go. Fill in the gaps with your words. Hamza, no problem. So young learners are still developing impulsively. We need to consider the cognitive demands of impatience. Curious, simple. Lots of beautiful words there. Beautiful students. If your words didn't match, can you help me find the right match? For example, for number one, what sort of word would be appropriate for number one? They are still fab, Steve. I like that one. They are still mentally... They're still developing mentally. They're still developing actively. Ooh, good. Quickly, let's have a look then at number one, what we got there. Good. Number two, any ideas? What have you given me for number two? That was a plural noun, children. That fits really well, actually. I had a different word. That should have been tasks, of course. Books, kids, lovely. That makes a lot of sense as well. Number three, they need what sort of context do they need? Diverse, clear. Oh, that fits really well as well. I had the word familiar. So there's no wrong or right if you have different words because it makes sense. Yeah. Looking at number four, they need what to understand. Help. Very nice, Irene. They need a teacher to understand. Possibly they need support, help, guidance, scaffolding. Beautiful words. And what number? I'm really curious to see what numbers you came up with because that's really a random shot, isn't it? Six. Until one, they don't have the knowledge. Well, if you look at research, they would say until the age of 11, they don't really understand the meta language of of language. So they don't really know what a noun or an adjective or an adverb is. So this activity, hence, is really good for your lower secondary, or maybe when you look at primary at the end of that age range. And they need, of course, to notice things. It's not that they learn by us just talking about it and picking it up. We need to make it interesting. We need to make it clear, as you said before. We need to highlight what we want them to do exactly. Make it visible. Yeah, so these are the considerations that we need to take with us when we start to look at our classroom and think about how can we actually start developing that learner independence. Cognitively, we're developing till the age of 25 or maybe even later. Your prefrontal cortex, that bit in your head that you use to take good decisions based on rationale and not based on your feelings, that develops, and it takes quite a long time. Yeah. The demands of the task, of course, we need to think about, is this achievable for our students? And indeed, they get easily distracted, so we don't want those tasks that are too long. When we talk about familiar context, I'm thinking about songs, games, stories that they can actually relate to. It is meaningful, because one of the things that you notice with children, if they are not interested because it doesn't mean anything to them, they're not going to pay any attention. Try talking to a six-year-old about global warming. If they have no idea what it is, they're off. They're doing something else. Also, when you think about familiar context, I think when we talk about developing learner independence, familiar activities. You can use the same game with different words again and again, and they know how it works. So automatically, you can actually reduce your role and they can run the activity more independently. Last thing to notice things, we're going to talk about that more as well. We need to make very explicit what they want to do. Hun, very good question. Meta language is the language that we teachers use to talk about language. So, for example, if I say this is an adjective, you know what it means. This is the present perfect, you know what it means. But if I say to my six-year-old, we're going to study present continuous, it probably looks at me and goes, can I eat it? Because they don't really understand. It's too abstract. And they don't have that understanding until that later age. I hope that clarifies. Excellent question. Good. So this is what we really need to keep in consideration. And of course, they need short activities. They need movement. They need fun. And that is really important when you want to develop learner independence, because it needs to suit the children's developmental level. Now, before I'm going to talk about what sort of strategies you can use to develop age-appropriate or developmental-appropriate learner independence, I want you to do another activity for me, if you don't mind. And again, I'm going to give you some choice. The activity in a minute that you're going to get from me is called Complete a Sentence, or Complete My Sentence, actually. And you can choose again. You can use the chat box. You can write it down, and if you like, you can even use your voice and shout it at the screen. I'll try to listen very hard and see if I can hear you. Yeah, so you're going to choose which one or which way are you going to do this activity? Chat, write, or shout? You choose. Let me know in the chat box what you're going to do. I hope there's some people shouting, because I quite like that. Lots of people writing today and chatting. Anyone shouting at the screen? My kids would go for shouting. No one yet. Oh, Nabila, fabulous. My kids love shouting out at the screen. Get them to turn off their mics and shout the answers. It is still good pronunciation practice, right? Good. So you have chosen how you're going to do it. Now you need to choose, in a minute when I give you the sentence that you need to complete, are you going to give me one word or maybe a short definition? Your choice. Good. So are you ready? You're going to write, chat, or shout, and you choose one or two. Are you ready to complete my sentence? Here we go. I'm interested in your opinion, and I'd like you to complete this sentence for me. I think learner independence is what? Wow, amazing words here. I see a lot of one word synonyms. Essential, great. Oh, becoming autonomous. That is a beautiful sentence, Sonia. Little phrase, sorry. Paramount. Now that's advanced. I haven't seen my kids coming up with that, but Saranya has a really nice one, letting the learner choose what he wants to learn and how. Difficult to achieve, Jim Christopher. It's not an easy thing. And I think we never said it was easy, but it is super important. And indeed, Michael, I very much agree. It's imperative. It's crucial. It's something that we need to give our children. Nice one, Kalopi. Being able to study on their own. Now, I don't know if some of you who were shouting at the screen said this. Or maybe some of you who were shouting at the screen said this. But I think there is a truth in all of them. It is indeed not easy, but necessary. Sometimes you think, oh my God, I need a miracle for this child to do it. It's a need. And it is indeed having ownership, having that autonomy. Yeah? And it's not easy to achieve. And sometimes you do wonder as a teacher, it is a myth. I think the most important thing I can tell you about that is that it is a process. Yeah. When I start teaching grade three, for example, or grade two, it takes me about 3 months to get my students to behave in the way I want them to behave, which is tidying up their desk, hanging up the coats, showing helping hands. That is already a way of developing rules, routines, and some sort of autonomy in a child-appropriate way. And that takes about 3 months of coming to school full-time. So yes, we never said it was easy, but there are ways to get them there. I'm going to give you this definition. I'm going to let you read this for a minute. Elif, I think that's really true. It is a process. And in the beginning of lockdown, it was very hard for some of my learners to do things independently. But once they get used to it, we maybe have explained, we have modeled it, they become more able to do so. And I think thinking about it as a process from here to there, there's a long way to go. That explains very, very well why things take time, because they're little people, right? But they can take ownership, they can work with goals, they can make choices, and they can decide how they want to do activities. You have just done that. You have chosen chat, write, or shout. Students can do that too. And that's already a wee step towards learner independence, making those choices. Actually, it's not so much making those choices for the learners. It is us allowing them to make those choices in the classroom, which is maybe the most difficult thing, because we want to protect them. We want to help them. Good. Beautiful definition from Springer. What does it mean for the learners? They need to know what the goals are of their learning, what strategies they can use to get there, what sort of mindset they have to bring to the classroom, and what sort of learning habits, like making choices, making good choices, they need to develop. What do we need to do? I think first thing as teachers, we need to raise awareness of the fact that we want them to be more active participants, not active participants in the way of making or touching or moving things, but active participants in the learning. What do you want to learn? How do you want to do it? So we need to raise that awareness by reflecting, for example, on giving them choices. Yeah, what were you just doing? Why do you think that was good? Did you like it? Can you do that again? Can we do it with this as well? then also we need to create that attitude in our classroom that our learners want to be involved. They want to make choices. There's a willingness to try, even though they might think, I'm not sure how to do this yet, teacher. That is completely fine. So that awareness, that willingness, and then your last step, of course, is that we need to, them to change their role, to change their behavior. And that is at the end of that step. That takes indeed time. Start with awareness raising, making sure they're willing to try, that they're willing to give it a go, and that over time will change that behavior. So they become more active in making choices in learning, because that actually is what learner independence is. Yeah, good. And I just brought it up already. I think this question, another one. Good. I'm just going to go back quickly then to learner independence and why it's so important. I think Elif already said in the beginning of the year it was really difficult for learners to work. It became easier. That's very nice, because that links very, very good with this theory. If you look at independent learners, they actually, looking at research, are more motivated learners, because they're more motivated. They put more effort in. They work harder. They actually are more successful. What happens if you're more successful? You become more confident. And when you're more confident in learning, you actually find pleasure. And like all of you who have done all these PD summer courses, you turn into a lifelong learner. And that is what we want to create for our students as well, that opportunity that they can be lifelong learners if they want to. Yeah, so it's not only for us in the short term that it makes online teaching easier, it's also in the future. But of course, looking at our current situation, if they can be more independent, that gap, the knowledge gap that maybe there is if we don't study at home, hopefully we can reduce or avoid that is coming into existence. Yeah. So really, when we start to teach learner independence, we're sowing the seed for them to become lifelong learners. And like I already said before, I think it's worth asking yourself as a teacher, do you actually encourage this in your classroom? Yeah. You don't need to answer this question, but this is something for you to think about, because I think that the biggest enemy of learner independence in the classroom is sometimes the teacher. We want to be too helpful. We want to do all the talking. We want to handhold, support, scaffold. But there's so much they can do themselves already. Even if they are quite young, they can still do so many things without you. So indeed, Sahar, it increases student talking time. It reduces your role. It gives them more responsibilities, more confidence, and we need to avoid this deficit thinking. Indeed, Navid, you become more of a facilitator if you think your learners can do it and we give them the opportunity. I'm always very saddened to hear some teachers telling me, oh, they're too young, they can't do it. I believe if we create the opportunities in a very structured way for them to show us what they can do so much more than we think. If it doesn't work, you are still there on the side as facilitator, and then you jump in to maybe support them more or even teach it as an explainer. Yeah, so really think about this before you go and start this. And I think a lot of things that we do and don't do in the classroom really comes out of our own experience as a student. How were you taught? What was your model in the classroom? How did that happen in the classroom? Was it very teacher-led? Was it very student-led? It's all got to do with our experiences, and they have impacted our beliefs. So what I like to do before we go and look at these practical activities very quickly is have a look at your beliefs about young learners and learner independence. Yeah. So we're going to explore that, but we're going to do it in a YL way. So if you can, and you're not sitting in a library or in the bus stop, I'm going to ask you to get a little bit active in a moment. So I'm going to give you 6 statements. I'll read them out. If you agree, you're going to jump up. If you disagree, you're going to squat. Bit of good exercise for our kids. So move your chairs away if you want to. If you're connected, be very careful. And if you agree, you're going to show me. a jump. If you disagree, you're going to squat. Good practice. Kids love it. Now, if you're sitting in a bus stop or in the library or you feel a little bit embarrassed, you can also just go agree, disagree, your choice. Yeah. So if you've got your bodies ready, hands ready, ears ready, good. First statement I'm going to give you. Don't show me in the chat box what you think. Show me with your body what your answer is. Learner independence means learning alone without the teacher's help. Are you going to jump? Are you going to squat? Excellent. Good. Next one. Teaching young learners independence should be part of every subject. Agree, disagree, agree. Oh, I think I agree. Great. Jump. I like that. Show me your jump. Number three. My materials don't show me how to teach learner independence. Agree, disagree? Don't know, maybe a little bit of both. Some jumps there as well. Good. With young learners, we can use their first language to develop learner independence. Agree? Disagree? Next one. I didn't learn this at school, so I can't teach this. Maybe you agree, maybe you disagree, maybe a bit of body language. Ooh. And the last one, jump a little. I love that one. Six-year-olds are too young for learner independence. What do you think? Jump, squat, clap, thumbs. Good. I'm as pink now as my dress, I think, with my cheeks from all the jumping. Good. Sit down, relax. And cool down. This was indeed, Jim, a little workout. But I think if you do something with like this with children, they're learning, they're still listening, listen and do, and they're fully engaged because they really like it. If you sit at the bus stop, it maybe looks a bit weird. So that's why I gave you that option. And that's maybe more appropriate for your lower secondary or your teens. And you can even use these reaction buttons in Zoom for true and false activities, right? So, good. Let's cool down, team. Phew. Let's have a look then at these sentences. Now, I think one of the first issues with learner independence is that we think it's alone. When we talk about young learners, learner independence is the end point. It's the goal. Yeah, so we need to go towards that. So no, it's not the starting point. They need your help in the beginning. They need your support. Yeah. I think it should be a whole school approach. Now, number three, I did a bit of both true, false, agree, disagree. I think it depends on what you use. Macmillan has awesome materials that actually integrate learner independence in the materials. So go and check that out. I think there's nothing wrong with using that first language. Really important because you're developing a concept. Learner independence is much easier to talk about maybe in their first language. There is no issue with that. It's not about language learning at that stage. It's teaching them what it means to make a choice to decide for themselves and integrate English in that process. I think the last one, I disagree because you are here so you get some ideas. And I'm sure slowly, slowly, it's a process for us to develop that learner independence and know how to teach it. And six-year-olds are too young. I already told you. I mean, look at six-year-olds. They know what they want to wear. Even a two-year-old, they know what they want to eat. And they already know which apps to choose on the phone. Yeah, so I don't think they're too young. They're at the prime age to actually start making choices because they're going through this, no, I can do it myself stage. They've just maybe come through kindergarten, had some positive learning experiences, and they can see that learning can be fun and they like to make choices. This is also where at their age group, they're trying to push the boundaries more and more. They're pushing to see how far they can go because they had a little taste of it. Who do you want to play with? What game do you want to play? And now, certain things they can't choose. They don't like that. So I think with the right chance, with us giving them that chance, allowing them, stepping aside and giving them those conditions, we actually can develop learner independence. Yeah. So good. Let's have a look then how we can put them in that driver's seat. Now, like I already said, it's the end goal. It's not where we're going to start. So there's this whole spectrum. We often talk about dependent learners, independent learners, but really it's a process, right? And it doesn't happen overnight. For example, let's go back. Do you remember how you got to tie your shoelaces? I don't know if you remember, but I know pretty well. How did you learn this? How did you learn in school? How did they go about that? Intrigue now. They give you play shoes. Imitation learning, Heike. My mum taught me. I think if you think back to this whole process, Kimberly, your dad taught me, I'm pretty sure that dad was showing you how to tie a shoelace, right? So they were showing you, demonstrating, modeling. From that modeling and looking at it, you were trying and practicing yourself. Didn't always go well, but you were having a go before you were able to do it alone. So I think what we need to do is when we look at this journey, we need to insert a stage in the middle. Yeah. So from a dependent learner, whereas the adult does, to the independent learner, the child does. When we're looking at learner independence, where we want to start is in the middle, where we sort of do it together. We are a coach, a facilitator, a guide on the side to get them going in the right direction, making good choices, using the right strategies before they're going to do it alone. So it comes down to a gradual release model. I do, we do, you do. Yeah, we become learning partners to enable them to do it later on independently. So that modeling, that looking at what other people do is really important. And then, of course, you need to do it yourself. Because co-driving, yeah, it is a good start. That is why where you are starting to create your own learning. And then we need to create those conditions for learning. So we need to provide an enabling structure or a framework for learners to build those learner training practices into our daily teaching. So they actually become aware of goals, skills, all these things they need, and we need to allow them this. Yeah? So what do we need to build into our teaching? We need to give them something very important. If you've got any idea what we need to give them, it's all about the money. Yeah, different song, different word for money, synonym. Indeed, Amani, it's all about the trust, rewards. Start with a C, four letters. Oh, today it starts with a K. I'm sorry. We need to give them the cash. Indeed. So we need to give our learners the knowledge about what they are going to learn. They need to know what the goal is. They need to know how to make choices. Then we need to give them the attitude of, I can do it, I want to try. You trust me, so I can believe in myself. Then we need to give them the skills, the tools to do all the tasks we want them to do. And those skills, like tying your shoelaces, we need to model. And then get them to practice that with our feedback on that, of course. And then we need to create good learning habits. So we need to show them routines of learning so they can actually copy that and start to use that themselves. So there will be a lot of this in your daily teaching online or face-to-face. So they become aware of this, they get the right attitude, and then they can start to change their behavior. So let's look at the first one then. They need to know about the goals and they need to know that they have choices, that it's okay to make choices. Yeah? Now, I'm not going to talk about the right level of challenge of the task. We already spoke about that a little bit, but we need to make sure that it's of the right level. It's not too easy. There's no learning. It's not too hard because they get super frustrated and they don't want to learn. It's got a bad effect on their behavior and their love for learning. Yes, so the right level that you think this they can do a little bit harder of challenge. I'm going to talk about goals and allowing choices. So first things first, let's look at the goals. I think one of the things that I see happening a lot is that we teachers don't share the goals. We just do an activity and learners have no idea what they're doing or why they are doing it. Yeah, so we need to tell them what they are going to do. If you want them to get on the road to learn their independence, they need to know the end station where they are going. So it's really important that we make that clear in student-friendly language. So what do we want them to know, understand, or do? Sometimes you read about the kudos, know, understand, and do. In student-friendly language, why am I doing this activity? Oh, because I'm learning words for animals. I'm learning to talk about animals. I'm learning to write about my best friends. So they clearly know what we are doing. And I think it's really invaluable to teach them to start using those WALTs, as we call them in primary education. We are learning too, a little statement in an activity or above your activity. I'm learning to write about activities I like and don't like to do in my free time and why. Yeah, so they really know what they need to work on. The I is very important because it shows the student, it's me. I have a job as well in the classroom. It's not just the teacher. And as with any other thing you do in the classroom, particularly when you set things for homework, your instructions need to be crystal clear, short, simple, straightforward. I would say when your learners are learning a lot from home independently, record them, put them on the slide, talk about it, show them what you're doing, send them the little video, and they know exactly what it is they need to achieve at the end of this activity. So your WALTs, share the goals with your learners. Then also we want them to make choices, and you can start very, very small with making choices. How many sentences do you want to write? Yeah, I know in mind what I have for the students, but see how much they give me. How much time do you think you need? And particularly when we're working and studying from home, you might be a bit more lenient here. You know, how much time do you like? When do you want to hand it in to me? Where do you want to study? So all these choices we can offer, not all at the same time, but little by little, sprinkle it through your teaching. That means that students take responsibility. When they make a choice, it's their choice. They feel proud and they put more effort in. Which tools do you want to use? Do you want to write it on Padlet? Do you want to write it in an email to me? Or do you just want to write it on paper if they are doing a writing task? They can draw, of course, online. They can draw on paper. They can tell you about the weekend in written form. They can tell you about the weekend when they recorded on WhatsApp, for example. A nice one I use is I like my students to choose their tasks when they work at home. So, for example, this is a phonics choice menu, 6 different activities. If you want to find the activities, go to macmillanicinternationalcurriculum.com. There are 6 activities I've written for young learners to do at home developing phonics skills, and they can just tick which one they want to do. So they have a choice. Yeah, they're all set up to do independently with instructions for parents. But also, I don't know what they choose. So I like them to record which activity they did and think about the why. Why have you chosen this? Because for me, when we meet, because some students I don't see more often than once a week, we get together and say, oh, you did the word slap. Why did you do the word slap? Teacher, I like it. Little things like that. I think, okay, that's the beginning, but what did you learn in the word slap? So it is also a nice conversation starter. And at the end, they have to choose how well they did. Golden medal, silver, or bronze. So a bit of reflecting. Good. Then the attitude that we want to nurture in our classroom, I think somebody already wrote it in the chat box. They need to have trust. So they really need to know that you are there for them. And that first activity I was asking you about what you did in your holidays, remember to refresh, to reach out. I was actually just getting to know you, build rapport. And I think that is very important with your students. If you don't see them very often, it's much harder, but even more important. So get to know about their life, find out what they're doing, pay interest. Once they see that, you have trust in them. I mean, if you don't show trust, if they don't trust you, why would they care about their learning? And if they know that you actually believe in them, they can start to believe in themselves. So the next step, when they know they have that trust, you believe in them, we want them to believe in themselves. So here, growth and fixed mindsets. I don't know if you are familiar with that. It's absolutely interesting to read about. Carol Dweck, the book is called Mindsets. Really nice book, but it's not for children. So what I have made for my learners, I made, are you a shark or a dolphin activity? Who do you think is more helpful, the shark or the dolphin? Which animal do you think is more helpful? A dolphin. Yeah, well, I actually don't know, Mahasi, because sharks are actually really important for the world. But we do have this belief that dolphins are more helpful. Yeah. So good. Dolphins, helpful thoughts. Sharks, scary, dark thoughts. So on Jamboard, I've got all these different stickies with language that my students understand. If not, make it simpler. Put it in the first language. And then I get my students to decide, who do you think said, I can't do this, dolphin or shark? Have a go if you want. Who said what, dolphin or shark? Ah, good. Oh, but I can't do this yet, but maybe later. Who said that, the dolphin or the shark? Yay, Safa! The dolphin says, yet, because not now, but I do believe I can do it later. So my students together look at the language and we move it around. And then we have two different groups. The groups of positive thinkers, growth mindset, I can learn. Maybe not yet, but it's okay. I can ask for help, I'll get better. And the sharks, which is more the fixed mindset, not so useful for learning. So I'm trying to create an attitude in the classroom that my students actually say, it's okay to ask for help. It's okay, I can't do it yet, but I will get there in the end. I believe in myself. So very much a child-appropriate way to introduce that. And then, of course, I want them to be curious. I think we ask a lot of questions as teachers. Oh, by the way, so if you want to know the answers, this activity will be in the One Stop English blog for you. So you can copy it and use it with your students. Yeah, so you can check your answers next week online. Good. Going back to asking questions, we ask a lot of questions, and my students too. I bet you recognize these. Now, I'm not sure. This might be the best thing from online or offline teaching, that I don't get all those questions, although I get lots of emails from my students. But I like them to ask different questions. And also I want to teach them, questions is absolutely fine, but don't always ask me. Solve it yourself. So the activity we look in class at, which I try to teach my students, is ask four people before you ask me. Oh, please, teacher, why? I will add that. So I want my students not to come to me directly. Maybe something we can use at CELTA as well, actually. I want them to ask other people, the four Bs, before they go and ask me, because they need to solve it themselves. Who can they ask, or what can they ask? Any Bs for me that you think this is what we can use? B, B. Oh, what about that one? Mariana, peers, not beers. Ah, your brain, indeed. What about this one? Fabulous. So I'll teach my students, if you don't know the answer, if you have a problem, first ask your brain. Then look at your books. If not, maybe go to the browser, because we have a class blog. If not, go and call or text or email your buddy or your dad or anyone else in the house. Then if you still don't know it, absolutely fine. come and ask me. Yeah, so this will also be on the blog for you. Right, we're moving on to the S. We need to teach our students skills and support. So we need to teach them how to do things because that is really important, what strategies to use. And I think the most important thing here is that modeling, that you show them how to do it. Feedback, as somebody mentioned in the chat box, is really important as well, but I'm not going to talk about feedback. I'm going to talk about that modeling. So when you set an activity, show them how you do it. Don't just say, do the activity and do it alone. That's not helping. A great tool is Seesaw. It's a safe classroom site where you can have a portfolio of all your students, and you can actually upload a task. If you don't have that, go to Edmodo, Google Classroom, or the Padlet. Record yourself with your phone, or maybe use Loom, which is for free and it's fabulous. Tell them what they need to do. They can watch it, write the instructions underneath, they can read it, and then they can copy you and do it. But show them how to do it. You know, when we make meaning, we can't just make meaning. Think aloud. That is my tip there for you. So one of these things, look, say, cover, write, check, is a great strategy. I teach my students. I teach my students when they see a new word to look at it. Look it again, and then say it three times, cover it. Then we write it and we check it. And I'll do it in front of the camera so they can see what I exactly do. Model that technique. It's a great way to develop their spelling skills. Yeah, so don't just say, remember the words. No, this is a strategy you can use for spelling. Let's do it together. Next time we do it as a group, then you do it alone. Good, and the last one is creating habits, habits of mind. They're not easy to create, but if we keep repeating all the things we're doing, I do think they get closer to good learning habits, which is what we want to instill. So for example, routine, you could create a timetable for students that work from home and are not coming to school, but be flexible, right? Because they're strange times. Parents might be at home, there might be one computer, kids might be stressed. So be a bit lenient there. It's more important that they do it than when they do it, I think, at the moment. Most important, what I want to look at with you is creating a culture of excellence. Do you remember this? I'm learning to write. What did I call this little thing, that goal that I share with my students? Who remembers? It was called Sarah, beautiful, a WALT. Now the WALT, of course, is the goal setting at the beginning, but at the end, I want my students to check their work before they give it to me, and I want them to be proud of what they do. So they need to know what I am looking for as a teacher, also called their success criteria. So you write your work, and then please, before you give it to me, check. Can you say what activities they are? Yes. Can I say why? Oh, yes, I've put that in there. Check. And maybe I can say when, or maybe I can say who, or whatever else you want to include. I think that is really important for your students, that they learn how to check things themselves. Yeah. Good. And of course, we want them to reflect on their learning now, because we're nearly at the end of the webinar. I'm going to use this activity with you as well. So many different ways to reflect and exit tickets of learning. There's lots of different tools, 3-2-1s, one question, one thing you liked, 3 medals, 3 stars, a star and a wish. But I like this one because the first question, what have you learned today, is really that cognitive engagement. What have you learned about the English language? How did you do this? Carefully, quickly, alone, with help? And then the last one, so the second one is about the practical side, the skills. And the last question really relates, like, how did they feel doing this? Was it a positive feeling? Are they proud of themselves? Was it hard? Was it difficult? Then at least I know that I need to help them a little bit more. Yeah. Good. So I'm going to wrap up my webinar, and I have got a few more things to quickly say for you. So looking at this journey, always start where they are and get them to drive with you. And if you need to give L1 and use the L1 in the classroom to get them slowly to the driver's seat, that is all right. But be flexible, be encouraging, and particularly be patient, because things take time. And if you want your students to use the cash, their knowledge, their attitudes, their skills, and their habits, you need to step aside and allow them to try themselves. And often that is the biggest challenge for us teachers. And TTT, who knows? This is something we really need to know. It's not teach talking time. Things take time, so be patient. But in the end, as Maria Montessori says, it's the greatest sign of success when we are no longer needed in the classroom. And that's what we do it for. So thank you so much for being here today. I hope it was useful. You got some practical ideas. I will write up most of my ideas on the One Stop English blog so you can get a lesson plan to start applying this to your classroom with the learners. It was a pleasure to have you here. And I'm going to leave you with the slide of Books for Inspiration and hand over to Will. Thank you, team.
Thanks very much, Anna. That was absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank everyone for being here and staying with us. That was amazing.
I know, you had some great chat, didn't you? It's nonstop.
I know.
What an amazing audience you've got today.
Lovely.
They're still going. They're still going. Yeah, you've got a lot of love, Anna, throughout the entire thing. From about 15 minutes into it, there was just love going towards Anna the whole time.
And I just want to say that I really appreciate, because I know it's a very busy time for the teachers at the moment to go get back to school, get themselves ready. So I really appreciate you take time out of your busy schedule to join us here. Fabulous.
Yeah. So we've run a bit over, but we've had one question earlier on, which I wanted to ask you because it's a good question, I think. So from Michaela, she was asking, is it okay to give the option to the learner to participate at all?
We're talking about online learning or face-to-face learning or just in general?
In general, I think it was back when you were talking about asking them to just, you know, to get involved in their goals and what they're going to do to get there. And they're asking, should you even put the question to them of, do you want to do this task or would you rather not do this task?
I think when we're in the classroom, we are a team, right? So I really like my students to show their willingness. And if there is a student who doesn't want to participate, I definitely want to have a chat and first of all, find out what's going on. Because some learners, and I think particularly after everything that has happened, not being able to go and see their friends, some learners might not be willing or might not be able to learn because there's too much going on in their lives. Mm. But if there is no valid reason that I think, yeah, I think we need to find a way that was okay, let's solve it and fix it and see how you can participate. And okay. Then get a route going to get them more involved in the learning, because in the end, I don't do the learning. They need to do the learning themselves, right? Yeah, so absolutely. No, I wouldn't give them the option. Do you want to join or not? Because particularly with teens, they're off.
Okay. Great. Thanks, Anna. Well, I think that's all we're going to have time for questions. But I wanted to say a couple of thank yous. So firstly, thank you, Anna. I think I speak to everyone. I think everyone has already thanked you, but I'm going to thank you myself as well. Thank you so much for such an interesting, very clear presentation as well, with lots and lots of really useful advice. So thanks for putting the time in to speak to us all today.
It was a pleasure. It's lovely.
And thank you very much to you, the teachers, of course. Thank you very much for joining us today. This was the first webinar of our Back to School webinar series. Really hope you enjoyed it. It looked like you did, that you've learned plenty. I really hope you have. And thirdly, thank you to Federica. She's not here. She can't be seen. She's sort of a ghost looming above the webinar somewhere. But she's doing everything to keep this thing up. So thank you very much, Federica, for sorting this all out for us and for being there for your and for being there for us with your support. Thank you.